All right. So today we're going to be talking about a really important concept and philosophy in order to attain inner peace and harmony with everybody else. So in order to harmonize differences with all other people. And this is kind of a continuation of healing relationships, which we talked about, forgiveness and apology, but also with a lot of the discord related to ethnic differences in the world and stuff like that right now. This is going to be a little bit of a boot camp that will help you internalize the wisdom needed to help yourself wherever needed, but to help others and give them insights and perspectives to harmonize differences. Okay. So insights and perspectives to harmonize differences. And I've done this a lot conversationally with people when they do have some unhealthy or toxic views towards other groups. Then I do this conversationally. So I'll share with you some of the different things that I've done that really help people make that shift because they're stuck in a certain way of thinking. So that's going to be one of the purposes. Another is to gain deep insights into the shared human condition, to cultivate deeper compassion for other people, dissolve limiting classifications such as family, color, creed, so you can become a better world citizen and treat everyone like family. So that is the intention behind our talk here today. So one of the main things is this. People can tend to have a value of seeing how we are all different or seeing how we are all the same. And the way we see the problem is the problem. So focusing on differences can divide people on superficial classifications like color, size, shape, beliefs. However, when you focus on how we are similar rather than how we are different, you will actually create greater unity with other people. And you'll be able to find unity amidst diversity. So the main thing is focus on how we are the same, not how we are different. That's where a lot of the problems begin, right? So that's why there can be a limitation when we talk about race and we try to say, view our race as the same. It's like we should just transcend that way of looking at people. Like, don't even look at the color because you know what? You take the skin off and everybody's red underneath. So we shouldn't even be validating that as a classification, in my opinion, in order to really find harmony. So there's a number of ways that we want to just reflect on how we are all similar. One is, how are we all similar physically? Who has any ideas you want to share? And I'm just opening it up just to see what kind of ideas you guys can come up with. And then I can fill in some of my own ideas on it. How are we all similar physically, regardless of all the other superficial classifications?
Well, we were all created the same.
We're all carbon-based life forms.
We were...
Yes.
I break it down to that level. And then we start from there.
Okay, great. I love that one. Patty, what's your idea?
Nothing here. Now. That was fantastic. No, I don't have anything to add to that. Are you kidding me?
I'm just gonna call him Carbon Chris.
Carbon Chris. Hey, we all came from the womb, you know?
There you go.
So
that's it. And if I go out with anybody, that's called carbon dating.
What Patty's saying is we've all gone through similar biological stages of development. We all started as a fertilized egg, all of us. We were all born. We were all babies. Mm-hmm. And actually, before growing up and taking on family and social characteristics, as babies, we were all very, very similar at one point. Like across all the world, all races and classifications, babies are very similar. Anywhere in the world, whether it's an Asian baby, a black baby, white baby, whatever, They're all actually very similar. So we've all gone through that similar journey. Absolutely. Celine, do you have anything to add? How we are similar biologically?
Well, I guess biologically we all die at one point. We have a finite a time here on Earth, and no one person has an advantage over other when it comes to death.
Yeah. Yeah, so we all share a common endpoint, right? We all share a common ending with physical death. Now, I would also say, I would also add to this a lot more, and I would include that we all have vulnerability to injury, bones that break, we bleed when we're cut, I believe is a Shakespeare reference. We all have vulnerability to disease. We all have similar biological requirements. We all need nourishment and shelter to live, clean air to breathe, a healthy functioning circulatory system, healthy functioning digestion, healthy functioning system of elimination. We all have similar physical reactions. You know, believe it or not, doesn't matter who you are, like what culture, apparently just about everybody puckers their lips when they taste something sour. Like, that reaction unites all of mankind. It's like everybody puckers their lips when they, and that shows that common humanity of all of us, right? So, and somewhere down the line, we all share common ancestors, you know, with early humans. And in another way, we all battle the same physical opponents. We are all in a battle with physical aging. We all battle sensations of hurt, of hunger, thirst, physical exhaustion, physical weakness, all of these. So in summary, if we total all of this up, do we have more in common than our differences? Yeah, and that is the perspective that needs to be reinforced for a sense of common humanity, is really, really stacking how we are all similar compared against the minute examples of how we're different, right? So now skin color is like nothing. It's like one out of many different factors that we can compare on. So if I'm in a conversation with somebody, and this is how I'll help them make a shift, by getting them to see and acknowledge how they are much more similar to the population or group that they have a disharmonious difference with, that they are much more similar than different. So I start right there, right? Now, the next category we could go into is, how are we all similar in mind with mental, with psychological needs or emotions and everything else? So how are we all similar mentally? Who wants to share? Chris, do you have a very biological answer for us on this one?
for our needs of how we connect with others?
It could be, how are we all similar mentally? We talked about physically. How are we all similar mentally?
Mentally, we all want to have those same six needs that Tony Robbins talks about. Need for certainty, uncertainty, connection, love, contribution. So he really nailed the head on that as far as what the recipe book is. So you really can't move much further out than that.
Yeah, and so the six needs of the personality.
As far as that part, basically you connect to other people that way. And you can also run into how similar and how certain they can be with you. Well, I had one person who was like, he was going to start an argument with me because I look Puerto Rican, I look Spanish, and he was a white guy. And I said, I reminded him, we all carry blue passports. So he understood that connection, that we are similar. So there's that certainty that I'm an American and you're an American. So there's really no need to have too much of an issue with me. So it's how you connect with others. And I think it's how to connect on that emotional state. I even had a guy who said sheeple when I was like wearing my mask going into public. So I kind of turned around, like, looked at him. I said, I remind him, I have to wear this to go in because they won't let me in otherwise. They'll call the police. I don't want to be arrested, and neither does he. So it's just reminding things that are important to them about what creates that connection or that similarity from their point of view.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Love it.
And it's how I connect with a lot of my friends who and I have a lot of friends who do support, you know, anti-masking, and they're kind of the whole COVID thing, but I also remind them that, you know, there are consequences if you don't follow those rules. But just be smart and just be safe. Hey, that's all. That's all you can do. And whatever level of risk you want to take is individual to each person, but that's what their choices are, and that's what my choices are. And I still love them for whoever they are anyway. So I don't let it get...
So at times we all make... We are carbon beings that make good and bad choices.
Yes.
Okay, got it. I love it. I love it. Patty, how are all humans similar mentally?
Well, we all have the ability to think and make decisions. So, I mean, it's what separates us from, you know, being instinctive and animalistic, because we can cognitively think in that way.
Yeah. A lot of our free will comes down to our ability to make judgments on what we should or shouldn't do, judgments on what other things mean to us. And so we definitely all share that common humanity.
Free will.
For sure. Celine, do you have anything to add on this category? How are we all similar mentally?
I think Gov's covered it all. I don't know. I guess we all just want to be loved, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have human interactions, human connections with people. Although there are some people that I guess don't want that, and they're not well.
And you might even argue that everybody really wants that. They just have distorted ways
of doing that. Yeah.
Right? It's kind of like if you leave a dog home alone, it starts to tear apart all your stuff because it's a destructive way to get attention from you. And in the same way, we see humans who create relationship disharmony and make it look like they don't want love and connection when actually they just have a very destructive strategy, almost animalistic, to do that because they're looking to get attention. And they may do it through things they say and do that may otherwise deter people from it. So excellent point. Excellent point. Joel, how are all humans similar mentally? What comes to mind for you?
I mean, at a core level, I think most people want to, you know, avoid pain, move towards pleasure, want to find a sense of peace. Like, I think, you know, I don't think most people wake up in the morning thinking like, how can I, you know, be hurt or sad today? I think most people want to move towards something that's good for them. Obviously, we all have different definitions of what that looks like. And I have to believe, you know, even though it's hard to see sometimes, that, you know, for the most part, people want to love and do good for others as well. But I think a lot of times people just get distracted. But I think that's maybe a core value. You know, it's hard to say it across the board, but I think deep down people want to do the right thing and be nice. But I think there's a lot of things they get distracted by.
Yeah. They get confused. Right. So I think, you know, excellent points. I would add to this that everybody can suffer unfulfilled desires. Like, that is a common human struggle. suffering from various fears, fear of failure, fear of judgment, fear of success, fear of the unknown, fear of commitment. Like, there's so many different fears people all have to face. Also, you know, another thing that's very common to all human beings is pretty much across all generations and across all geography, human beings keep track of day and time. That's a mental priority that unites us all. You know, that human beings have always had like some sort of calendar system. And it's like, hey, we've kind of all done this. Across all cultures and all time, people participate in funerals and they grieve when someone they love dies. Like, all humans go through that, regardless of, you know, whatever religion or ethnic group they are. They also all enjoy joking around and sharing a laugh. There's not a culture that will not joke around and share laughs. Every single culture does that, right? They also all wonder about the world and how it came about and what the soul really is, right? So everybody is united mentally with these mental priorities that affect all of us, that we all participate in, you know, and we all live in the same universe of emotions. So we all experience happiness, sadness, and everything in between. We all have family we care about, right? And we are all battling the same mental opponents, which includes self-doubt, which includes indifference to wisdom, or lack of clarity on purpose and mission in life, or negativity, or sometimes jealousy or envy, or mental laziness, or pride and ego. Like, these are the mental opponents that we are all in battles with at various times in our life and to various degrees. So I think that, you know, when we realize that we're all kind of heroes in battle and we're all facing those same mental opponents, then there's a sense of camaraderie that comes across that with humans from all different places and all different, as much as we might seem different on a very surface level, with all of the deeper stuff that's really relevant to the human experience, we're all in that same battle, right? All these different cultures have people that are depressed, people that commit suicide. Every culture is dealing with stuff like that, right? It's the same mental opponents. So in summary, you know, mentally, do we all have more in common with each other than our differences? Absolutely, right? Like, and you can even build up, we could even go into more detail and build up more of a case on this. But it's realizing that we really are united mentally, and we really are much more the same than we are different. So the third dimension I would include are, you know, and this one's a little bit, I'm going to leave this one a little bit more open-ended, is how are all humans similar spiritually? How is everybody? So this is, I'm going to call this existence beyond the carbon, right? Like, so how are we all similar spiritually? Chris, do you have any thoughts? What?
I think we're similar spiritually, that most of us do believe in a higher being than ourselves, regardless of what name we give it, whether it be Yahweh, Allah, Vishnu, Jesus Christ, God. People do have a belief in a higher being. It doesn't mean they believe in churches and man necessarily, but they have a belief in a higher being. And how that connection is there, that means they are thinking beyond themselves, even when they think they're not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you make a great point.
So that allows...
you make a great point that everybody in society has kind of always been drawn to that sense of believing in something bigger than ourselves. And you have all forgiven on the wicked leg on your side. Everybody struggles with Zoom lag and unstable internet connection right now. We are all We are all united and similar in our technical challenges at this phase in the human story.
No idea what you're talking about.
Yeah. We have all tried to talk well on mute, right? Like. Joel, do you have any thoughts on how we are all similar spiritually?
Yeah, Chris kind of took mine. I think that's a really great question. It seems like, especially in religion, I mean, it's the same in politics and everything, but when you focus on the differences in religion, it's just like, you end up with the Crusades, right? You end up with holy wars, and you end up with suicide, because, my God's better than your God, your God, whatever. But yeah, that's when you can focus on, what are similar? Yeah, there's that. Or there's that perhaps that we're all loved, unconditionally. I don't know. I mean, maybe there's some that are more judgmental towards themselves, but like I said earlier, we all want to do kind of the right thing for the most part, which obviously there's exceptions to, but yeah, I guess when you really can focus on those universal similarities, it kind of breaks down barriers, which is great because there's a lot of barriers that are artificially put up.
You bring up a really good point. And I was talking to this one really well-known author, and he was telling me that the most destructive word in the English language was the word the. And the reason was, the minute they put that word in front of truth or Bible, then it created this mental sense of difference and exclusivity. Whereas previous, for thousands of years, there was no word the, because there was no sense of singular, one and only exclusive. So people would have different versions of what the truth was. They'd say, this is truth, not this is the truth. So the word the created a sense of growing pride and difference amongst people. So he said that actually led to more like wars and deaths and everything else, was the word the, and the shift in mindset that it created in people. Because it emphasized difference rather than commonality, right? Patty, do you have any thoughts?
Well, when you said wicked lag, I thought you said wicked leg, and I didn't understand. And I realized there's a lag, so I got it. I just think that when we die, our flesh becomes lifeless. So there is something spiritual that's within us. And so when that life is taken from our bodies and our bodies are limp and dead and cold, that which was in us is spiritual and has a spirit component to it. It is the spirit of our being. And so we all have that. That's what allows the flesh to move and breathe and have being and express, right? And so when I think spiritual, that's what I think of.
Yeah, I love that. It's kind of like this, if a guitar is strung, what do you hear? You hear some sort of sound, right? If a drum is struck, what do you hear? Or if a flute is blown, what do you hear? In all of these cases, what is really created is sound. And sound from different musical instruments is comparable to the human spirit manifesting through different bodily instruments. You know, so humans come in many different sizes, shapes, colors, and class concepts, but all have the same inner essence. The body is nothing more than a vehicle that is used to participate in this reality. We can work with it, but without getting attached to it, because it's, we're all the driver, not the car. And the way I look at it is, spiritually, everybody is like a light bulb. You're like the electricity that has illuminated the light bulb or the body, the physical material of the body, but you're not the bulb itself. And when the lights go off, the electricity goes back into the dynamo from where it came. And that's similar with the spiritual essence, right? So that can be definitely a way in which it's kind of a different expression through all of us. Celine, did you have anything to add to that? How are we all the same spiritually?
No, I think spirituality is like very similar across culture. I mean, there's of course, there are different beliefs in God, but I thought that, there's not much that I could really contribute more to that.
No problem, no problem, no pressure. So, one of the things, I'm not sure if you guys have heard of Swami Vivekananda, but Swami Vivekananda once said, you know, is the God in you the same God in all? If you don't see that, then true spirituality has yet to come to you, right? Because the same unseen, intelligent, intentional force is beating your heart when you're sleeping, is breathing your body when you sleep, is working your kidneys and liver for you. It's digesting and assimilating all your nutrients. That same force that we take for granted is working through all of us with impartiality to any of us based on creed, color, anything like that, right? So definitely we're spiritually supported in the same way. Also, you know, everybody struggles spiritually. Everybody struggles with the meaning and goal of life. That's a very common struggle amongst everybody spiritually. And everybody struggles with ignorance on how to best live a human life. So we've all shared that common struggle, and everybody is all battling the same spiritual battles between vice and virtue, like love versus fear, greed versus generosity, me versus we, all of those spiritual battles that we're all doing, right? So pride versus humility is a good example. So I think the more that we emphasize that commonality spiritually, then I think the more that it creates those differences between us. So in summary, what we've done right now is emphasizing how are we the same physically, mentally, and spiritually. Now it starts to create less of that mindset that is kind of disharmonious between different people. The next category is a super, super important one. Category 4 is, how are we all interconnected? How are other beings, in a way, an extension of your greater self? You know, so there's many different ways that you could answer this. But who's got some thoughts just off the top? How are we all interconnected as like a one world family, I would say? How are we all connected as a one world family? Chris? Patty, over to you first. Patty, you're in.
This is great. I just hopped right over Chris. I love that we are able to, that we all have a desire to connect relationally.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I wanted to say. I don't know if that had anything to do with what you were saying there, but that just popped in my head, and so out my mouth it came.
We are, and we're going to unpack that. You've definitely nailed on a category in terms of how we are all connected relationally. We'll unpack that and get even more specific. Anyone else have any thoughts on how we're all connected? I would say this. How do we depend on others for the lifestyle we enjoy?
Well, there's some people that think they could do it all, but that's actually not the right way to go about it. And we are interconnected in that in order to achieve success or do what you want, you need everybody to help you. You need other people to help you and have faith that they can help you. So we're interconnected in that way.
Love it. Love it. You nailed it. Like we all need everybody to play a role. Do you eat food that other humans have grown? Right? Imagine right. You had to grow your own food. You'd be so distracted. You couldn't do all this other fun stuff in life. You'd be like, I'm too busy growing food all day. And then when I'm done that, I need to knit my own clothes. Right? Like, think about that. And then I have to build my own house. You know how many hours, I got to figure out how to build a house, right? Like, you know, and also like in terms of these modern conveniences we enjoy.
Teamwork makes a dream work.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Was most of your knowledge communicated to you through a language that other humans created?
Okay.
Yeah, you didn't invent your own language and teach it to everybody else, right? That would have been too much. We can't do it all on our own. We are the beneficiaries of the humans that have lived before us, right? So, you know, if alone from birth, would you have turned out the way you did, or would you have remained very primitive and beast-like? Like even we would have been very much like Tarzan, you know, if that, right? So I think there's an illusion. It's actually, it comes from a very delusional state of egotism. So the ego deludes us into thinking we're doing this on our own or we're living an independent life is an illusion. We are part of a greater collective effort with the rest of humanity. And the more you emphasize that this is a greater collective effort, this is a group project we're all involved in, then the more you can feel that sense of compassion and connection with everybody else, right? So, and I think, you know, to touch on what Patty said, in your being, every single one of us carries a part of everyone you've ever met. You know, the wisdom, the shared communications, the relationships, they exist within you. And to some degree, you exist within others. Just the impact and the memory and the effect you've had on other people. There's definitely that harmonious exchange between everybody, right? So I think, you know, and I like to look at it as we're all co-travelers on this big blue green ship called Earth as it sails through the cosmos, right? So, Charmaine, how you doing? Good to see you. Big round of applause. Charmaine's joined us. Great to see you. Great to see you. Charmaine, I'm going to give you a quick summary on everything we're talking about.
Okay.
So basically we're talking about the wisdom needed to help us and help others harmonize our differences, to develop greater compassion, kind of looking at yourself as more of a world citizen rather than looking at superficial classifications, for greater relationship harmony in life. So a big part of it is focusing on how we're all very similar rather than how we're different, and rather than emphasizing differences. So we're similar physically in many different ways. We're similar mentally with the emotions and the psychological needs we have, and we're similar spiritually in many ways. So once we emphasize that, all of a sudden, skin color is just a tiny speck amidst all of these other ways in which we're similar. And the other thing is the ways in which we're all interconnected. You know, in which we are all the beneficiaries of the contributions from other human beings. Everybody kind of carries out an important role in society. You know, we all need the politicians in life. We need the lawyers, we need the school teachers, we need the janitors. No role is less important. Cooks, caregivers, laborers, because it's all a shared responsibility, contributing to the whole. And when everybody does the work that's natural to them, it creates a greater functioning one world family. So those are some of the different perspectives we've been unpacking related to related to everybody and everything on this spaceship called Planet Earth. Oh, and we're all carbon-based beings. Mouse drop. That was Chris who said that one. It was really funny. Actually, you got us all laughing. So those are some of the things to think about, is how we're all interconnected. You know, everyone wakes up with an alarm that was built by somebody else. We drive on roads that were maintained and built by other humans. We use vehicles that were conceived of, created, and sold to us by other humans. Like, this is a massive group project. So when we start to like hate on other people and stuff like that, you're actually hating on yourself in a way, because they're a greater extension of you in this sense. So the other category, category five, okay, is why should we have love and loyalty to all? And here's what I need to say about this category. I'm a big fan of, you know, loving family members is the first step in expanding your love, but you shouldn't stay fossilized in your ways of being and keep it small to an exclusive group. You should then take those skills that you've learned in a smaller setting and challenge yourself to expand it to all, rather than limiting it to the members of your immediate family, learning to give that same love to the whole world, basically. And that's where a lot of people really get stuck. They think it's us four and no more. It's us against the world, us and our family and this and that. And that's really a disservice to yourself, to your soul, and your life mission. So,
Can I add something?
Yeah, please do.
No, I just had a similar realization a couple of weeks ago of, you know, it's kind of more looking at the divisive nature of, you know, when people are classified into like, you know, Democrats and Republicans. And so I was looking at, you know, the fact that I have, you know, I myself, I identify as more a Democrat, or people that look, I realized I have neighbors that identify as Republicans, but they're really loving people. And I was looking at like trying to get to the core of it. And what I realized was people that have a conservative viewpoint, typically they're loving people, but they love the people that they know and that they trust, like people that are close to them. Like if it's a guy on a street, not so much. I don't know that guy. He could be a threat. Like it, not so much. But, and then it's kind of the other way, not necessarily completely opposite, but for people that have a more, you know, they get called socialists and stuff, but people that see the democratic good, like they want healthcare for people, they want good education for people, like they care about the people that they don't know, like that aren't necessarily directly benefiting in their family from these things, but they want to see social good that benefits all. And so I realize that both sets of people care about people, they just care about different people differently, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah, it's interesting to, I don't know, focus in on, yeah, I guess the common thread between the two, like, hey, we all care about people just differently.
Yep. And
I don't know if that really takes it anywhere differently, but.
And I think we're all on the journey of learning how to love better, ultimately, at the end of the day, right? So you can see where people are stuck at different levels. They're like, I'll love you, but if you're not from the same religious class as me, then I can't love you. And nobody else here says I'm allowed to love you, or whatever it happens to be, right? And I'm putting their happiness before my own, so I'm going to do what they say, right? So there, you can see where people can be stuck at different levels in their development with that. But the thing is this, also, they can never truly feel content when they're like that. And you'll notice that the greater the degree to which people struggle with conditions for loving other people, the less truly happy they are, right? Like, you just can't be truly happy in a world in which you're at disharmony with so many different people. So the crime is the punishment, you know? Whereas if you can just figure out how to just love everybody, then you're living in a world in which you're much more excited and motivated, because any stranger you meet is just like somebody that you would be excited to get to know, right? Rather than a perceived threat, you know? Like, so it's just all the different ways that people will, I think that's part of how to live a human life, right? Just create harmony with everything, you know? Anyone and everything. It's actually really funny. I don't know if, Joel, you normally see the posts I make on Facebook. But it was really funny.
I was going to say, I'm always trying to get closer to what you're doing.
I was doing a meditation, right? And I finished like a meditation practice, and I opened my eyes, and there's a skunk right in front of me. Like a legit skunk. And I was just like, this is cool. I'm going to harmonize with this. So I was like, honey, come on downstairs. I want to introduce you to somebody. We're going to have fun tonight, hanging out with my new friend. And it's a skunk at the window, like at the sliding door, looking at me. And I'm like, we're just going to learn to appreciate this guy. And we hung out with him all night. Now, I kept behind the sliding glass. I'm like, I'm not going to take a stupid risk here. But I filmed it and I threw it on Facebook. I'm like, yeah, we just made. And the funny thing is this. That skunk needed medicine. It had a skin condition. Same one with a squirrel I helped. So I had to give it its medicine the other night. It showed up. Anyways, but the same challenge is there. It's like anything that would otherwise disturb us, how can you just find a way to harmonize with it, right? Rather than choosing to be disturbed, choose curiosity and compassion. Like, that was my immediate choice. Curiosity and compassion. People hate this animal. It's a threat. Forget it. That's not the way to live a human life, right? So does anybody else have thoughts and suggestions on why we should extend love and loyalty to all instead of keeping it exclusive? Addy. That is a great tune. That's the anthem of today's call right there. You nailed it. We are the world. I forgot about that song. Thank you for that reminder. All right. Anybody else have anything on that topic there? Charmaine, any thoughts?
It's a hard one today.
It's a deep one. It's a deep topic. Yeah, I know.
It's a hard one today because I've been really frustrated with people this last week, and I'm feeling myself pulling back, you know, meeting people that, you know, disappoint you or aren't respectful to you, and knowing how to deal with that and how to handle that. And so for me right now, the topic's really hard, you know, because I do think I walk in with a genuineness with people and generosity. And when you're not respected in that, or, you know, people don't respect your boundaries, or, you know, try to understand who you are and know how to interact with you like that, it's very difficult. So
if I could share with you a strategy I use in those situations,
yeah,
just something to consider is this. When I look at people that are like that, okay, that are irrationally disrespectful or rude or whatever, I look at them and I try to just look into their soul and see their highest potential. And when I do, I realize that they've got within them the ability to be 10 out of 10 loving if they made the choice. They have the ability to be 10 out of 10 patient, 10 out of 10 disciplined, 10 out of 10 creative, 10 out of 10 merciful. Like, they have their highest potential is how I try to look at them. And I'd be like, you're not there right now. You're not there right now. You're struggling with this. You're experimenting with this strategy for living. It's an experiment you're in the middle of. But I know how this experiment works out. If you live this way, it leads to the same predictable consequences in life. No matter what, history will tell you time and time again, the more that you are selfish and mean and rude, it doesn't work out. So I'm like, you're in the middle of an experiment. I know how it's going to work out, but I also know your highest potential. So that's cool. So I won't really lose faith in these people, but it gives me a sense of peace to know that even if they are doing that, they're still going to make progress because that doesn't work out. And suffering is a great teacher, and they'll get the lesson the painful way eventually, you know, as long as they're paying attention. Eventually they're going to be like, how is this working out for me being this kind of a person, you know? So for me, that's where my mind goes, and I can find just peace with anybody that way. I'm just like, what's their highest potential? Like, they're just learning and doing, they think this is a good experiment. They think selfishness is the way to live, whatever, right?
But Brandon, that makes life so much easier if you don't have to judge people.
Yeah, I know. Crazy. And it shouldn't be easy or fun.
And it makes you feel better. And it probably lifts the situation up, even though it might be hard initially to have the inertia with that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So yeah, you know what? You're right. So you should copy them. Forget all these nice things. Just copy them and see how it works out. I mean, that's the thing is, if I think this, it's important for me that I recognize that everybody has their right to free will, just as we do, mm-hmm. right? We all have a right to free will to use or misuse it by our judgments of what actions we should be taking. So in the same way that I've had the freedom to choose wrong actions and wrong judgments in my life, I always feel like, who am I to say other people can't do that and learn these lessons the difficult way? Because when you learn it the difficult way, it's really memorable, mm-hmm. right? Like when you've lived in fear, which I think maybe all of us have at some point, I'm like, man, that's a memorable lesson. That sucked. Like, using fear as a motive sucked. But I always like to give people the space to let suffering be their teacher. Because I'm like, I know that won't work out. You're going to suffer. Like, you're going to be miserable and grumpy and lonely, and suffering's really going to get the curriculum across to you. So I can be at peace knowing that that is definitely, you're going to get some painful lessons that are going to help you ultimately.
And I often feel like, you know, I give people the space to be who they are, whatever that brings upon them, but I don't feel like I get the same space. And I end up getting disrespected through some of that, and I don't want to go into, you know, all of the details, but
yeah, of course.
I don't know how to hold that distance, because I'm not going to cut people out of my life like that necessarily, but I have to figure out how to handle them carefully, and that's sometimes very hard.
Yeah, and sometimes we're challenged because we expect people to be more advanced than they are, and they're really not as advanced as we think. We'd think this is common sense. How can you? No, sorry. Like, they can fool us. You can think they're really advanced, but they're not, right? Like, that's the reality of some people. If you come to a group like this, you'll find that within this group, you're not going to find anyone who's going to judge you.
Yes.
Or you're going to find people who are just going to respect you and stuff, but that's a different group. So sometimes it comes down to, like, expectations, managing expectations. It's like, no, I'm going to go to a group like this and they're going to be terrible. That's where they're at. They're like kindergartens. I wish they were like grade sixes, but they're not. They're like kindergartens.
Well, this group is special. This group is very special and very unique. But there are other people I've met through Tony Robbins type groups that, you know, say that they're all about personal development. They've done all this work on themselves. And then when you realize that's not who they are, sometimes that's really hard, you know, or hard to know how to handle them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It comes in time. You're on your journey learning how to create harmony with difficult people. That's a big lesson. Be patient with that one. It'll come in time. So, but thank you for sharing. That definitely brings some great perspective to the conversation tonight. One of the things I wanted to add to this about love and loyalty to all, I think Joel nailed it. Like, this is just, it ultimately leads to more happiness and freedom, right? But division, there was a quote, Yogananda said it, and it was like, division is imaginary lines drawn by small minds. It's the result of superiority complexes and is the cause of wars and troubles. Like, really. Like, that's it. Division really does cause all of that. And that's why I'm big on, let's get rid of all of those, all of the, that sense of division and look at how we're the same. The other thing is that you really remain hardened in your ego if your identity is focused on your earthly family. And I think it's all about viewing humanity as your greater family in order to break out of that hard shell of ego, like, which is really a lot of our source of suffering. So it really helps break down that ego and everything else. Like, and somehow in spirit, we are all family coming from some sort of a spiritual homeland before this material realm. Although we've forgotten a lot of who we are and where we're from, I think deep down when it all becomes clear to us, we'll realize how much more connected we all were than we may have thought when viewing reality through the lens of ego. So one of the challenges that I think is good as a takeaway on this item is to love everybody as long lost relatives. Like, have that attitude towards everybody. You know, just treat them all like all men as brothers, all women as sisters, the elderly people as parents, all kids as your own. Like, if you make that decision, like, what are the best possible outcomes? Because I know, like, you can meet people, if you have that attitude and you meet people, you're going to be able to click right away because they're going to sense that energy, that they're not being judged and that you're just accepting and embracing them. You know, so we have the natural tendency to love those who are dear to us. But if you see every person as family and you give that to others, then you start to harmonize more with reality and it makes it a happier life for you and everybody else. So here's the next point I wanted to discuss in tonight's curriculum. Why does all of this matter? Why does this specific wisdom and insight, this category of wisdom and insights, I call it common humanity, which is, I didn't coin that term or anything. That's a term I've heard used before. Why does this awareness matter?
It helps us to make friends and influence others.
What's
the book? Win Friends and Influence People or something.
How to win Friends and Influence People. Dale Carnegie.
Dale Carnegie, great book.
Dale in the house. Woo-hoo.
Dale in the house in spirit. Being channeled through Patty. Anyone else have any thoughts? Chris, why does this matter? This awareness of common humanity.
You're on mute.
You know, I Chris, I'm not sure if you can hear us. You've got a restless leg or lag there. You were on mute. I'm sure what you said was beautiful, if you don't mind repeating it.
Oh, sure. I think it helps open up the aperture and help people take a step back, relax, and make a call, which means instead of flying at 10,000 feet, we're in the middle of everything, doing your emails, doing your daily actions, and dealing with people on a micro level. It helps you step back to the 50,000 foot level, like an airplane, be able to see the whole bigger picture and be able to see people's humanity for who they are and how they're interconnected with other people other than yourself and things that you're not even aware of. It may help soften your view of this person enough to be able to tolerate them.
Yes.
And it helps you kind of see how everything else around you is connected so that you can make a better strategy. Soldiers cannot make a good strategy in a firefight. A general can make a good strategy because he sees the whole battlefield. This humanity theme allows you to see the whole battlefield, to see everything at a further distance, to see the people who are irritating, upsetting you. But why? Because they have these other things going on and they can't handle it very well, as you clearly are witnessing or a victim of. You can also see how people who do handle it well, and how are you handling your things? What can you learn from this person's humanity on how they're handling or not handling their situation? So even when you're dealing with professionals at work, I have a very sick secretary who drives us both crazy, between me and my dad. But I also see that she really would have a hard time getting a job somewhere else because of her lack of community, because of her other issues. But she still comes to work. She still deals with dad, which is a major part of her job description to begin with. So, I mean, there are things that can be valued other than just what's happening in the firefight, or just what's happening in her production level. So you have to look at it from multiple angles. So you're just not firing somebody and just bringing somebody in who's not gonna fit, because again, you're not looking at the whole picture. Also, when you do, in my dad's case, firing the secretary is not the brightest thing, because although she's not effective, although she has issues with computers and although she has issues with dope, she still comes in, she still tries to do the best that she can. And if you hired somebody else, it'd be someone young, someone to be gone in a month. That's why I call them employee of the month with my dad, because they don't last that long. So, well, the point I was trying to make is that in the Army, they also have a statement saying that if you fire this, if this person washes out of your program, you don't get a replacement. You have to work with what you have. Willing to be down minus one person and still carry the mission through because you're not getting a replacement. So going back to the humanity thing, you have to be able to look at all the different strategies. I know my dad's not looking at that part of it, but being able to step back and look at the overall strategy of what people are doing and how people are behaving and how their belief systems are affecting them and how things are functioning for them and how it affects other people around them and how it affects you. Then you can make a better strategy of what's going on around you.
I love that. You reminded me of something Seneca once said, and Seneca talked about how would it be if your hands wanted to go into a fight with your feet, or, you know, your eyes wanted to go to war with your hands, right? The whole benefits from the preservation of the parts. So that is basically what you're saying in terms of zooming out with the whole of society as one being gets along better with the preservation of its parts, right? So, definitely love it. Anyone else have any thoughts to share on why does the awareness of common humanity matter?
That's interesting. And I had the same realization the other day, even though I've kind of known it. But in terms of like thinking, you know, everybody is a mom and a dad. And, you know, so it's apparent to me, you know, so I'm in an RV right now. We sometimes go to RV parks. And you really get to see a cool slice of humanity because you're like right sandwiched between other families. You walk around the park and there's like 40, 50, 60 different families all kind of, you know, out and about. And kind of what you're saying about, you know, being able to get into that mindset where you just treat everybody like family at a core level, selfishly, like it makes you a happier person, but it also makes you a more effective communicator. Like you could, you know, I see some people that just kind of sit in their campsite and kind of like stick a screen in their face and they kind of shut themselves off from everybody. But it's so cool when you do treat people like people you care about and that, you know, people you would like to see, like, hey, how are you? You know, beautiful afternoon, you know, and find common ground and find commonality so that, yeah, I mean, to me, that's what, I wouldn't say like Christianity, but that's what being an effective person should be, is just even if that judgment is there, which it can be obviously easier said than done sometimes. But yeah, you just live, you come from such a better place of being happy and being I don't know, just at peace with things. Because it, anytime you start throwing judgment in, even if it's in, you know, my family, when I have challenges with a brother or something, like, it's anytime that is the motive that I work from, it just creates this like nasty animosity that's just poison. Like, you got to get rid of that stuff. And the antidote to that is just, like you're saying, being, seeing the love in everyone, even if they're not showing it, like choosing you, because all you can really control is you, right? You can only control the way you view things. You can't really change anyone, but you can choose, change the lens that you look through. So yeah, just really choosing to look through a, you know, an empowering lens that has the ability to put you in a state where people see that in you, like you say, that you can get, you can, they'll recognize that, and that just perpetuates the whole growing tighter and, you know, making people feel more loved and you feel loved, and it's a win-win-win all around.
Awesome. Awesome. Love it. Charmaine, any thoughts on why this awareness matters?
Well, I think it's the heart of getting anything done with people, you know, and we all come mm-hmm. from different backgrounds and have different perspectives on things. And that's not a right or wrong thing, but a lot of times it's a melding of different people that actually create the best ideas, you know? And so as long as we're open to having those conversations, it's not just getting to know someone, but it's also bringing about, you know, the best that we can be, just because we're open to, you know, learning from each other. And it changes us. It's not that someone's trying to change us, but being open to other people and learning from them is what changes you and makes you a more whole and better person.
Mm-hmm. Love it. Love it. Yeah, so what are the reasons? A number of the reasons why I think this matters is all war comes from selfishness. Selfishness comes from forgetfulness of the greater self and the interconnectedness of all of us. Right. I also think that if you weigh the return on investment to having disharmony with other people versus having harmony with other people, that harmony wins every time. If you weigh the return on investment, it is only intelligent to find a way ultimately to harmonize with people. Right. So, and when we do this, when we do this, we become more inspired to be moralistic and work together as team humanity, you know? So I also threw a couple of quotes into the chat that I thought were good. And I think also that at a deeper level, this attitude enriches your spiritual opportunities and your sympathies. And I think that's a bigger deal than far beyond even this topic today, but enriching your spiritual opportunities really gets blown wide open when you embrace this concept. So I like to challenge people to look beyond superficially binding associations like earthly family, ethnic race, geographical separation, because that just affirms limitation. All of that just affirms limitation, because we're all part of the same inherited biology, the same inherited realm of thoughts and emotions and sensations, regardless of skin color, genetics, family, lineage. We're all spirit family behind and before all of this. And pledging allegiance to that, I think, is really one of the secrets to living a successful human life, breaking through that limiting shell of ego. So the last category is really what needs to be remembered. And this might be different things to different people, what needs to be remembered. I think Chris kind of hit on, we need to remember to zoom out and see the big picture, how you're similar to others and how you're all connected. Another thing might be that accept that other people are just how we might be under similar circumstances to them, with similar life experience to them. Because in the end, we're just experimenting and trying to figure out the way that Joel said, how to create more happiness and how to decrease pain and suffering. And sometimes mm-hmm. people run really bad experiments, right? And although we can see it's not going to work out, sometimes you got to let them figure it out for themselves. right? And you've got to realize that all of this, all it's like we're all clumsy dancers stepping on each other's feet. And it's allowed to happen. And you have to trust that at some point that it's like, if that wasn't meant to happen, you'd probably have angels swooping down from heaven and breaking this up and being like, sorry, nobody's allowed to talk to you like that. I have to intervene, or whatever it is, right? So on some level, it serves a greater purpose, even and especially if we can't understand that in the moment, right? Coming to that sort of acknowledgement that across all space and time, a lot of the things we don't like end up serving us and serving a greater good in the end. So there was also a quote I really liked. Yogananda said, I'm just going to copy it and drop it into the chat here. Whoops, that was one. Here was another one. Kindness is the light that dissolves all walls between souls, families, and nations. So I thought that was a really good quote. Like, kindness really breaks that all down. Like, that's the power of kindness. So I thought that was really powerful. And I think also that Swami Kriyananda, I know I'm quoting a lot of swamis and gurus here tonight. I think they all had a lot of good wisdom on this subject. But the secret of prosperity is recognizing that people can be your best investment. So be a true friend to all, right? People are your best investment. Be a true friend to all. So really, it's like, challenge yourself to figure out what you need to figure out to love and respect everybody. Take that responsibility. Don't allow yourself to sit in disharmony with anybody. I don't allow myself, like, maybe like 60 seconds and that's it. And I'm like, I got to figure out a way to see things in which I can respect and honor and have love for that person no matter what. You know, even if it's somebody that cuts me off in their car, you know, like, it's just like, what do I have to do right now? I'm not going to sit in this state of disharmony. So anyways, those are some different things I have on what needs to be remembered. Why don't we go around the circle and then everybody just shares maybe a key takeaway from tonight's discussion in terms of something they got out of it or something they want to remember moving forward. Patty,
I think takeaways.
I'm voluntolling you. Key takeaway, Patty.
This is a difficult topic for me to absorb for myself tonight as well. I'm in it with Charmaine. You know, I'm in the middle of a six-figure contract negotiation, and the woman that I'm up against in the negotiation is a beep, and it's difficult. It's very difficult. She doesn't do her job well. She comes in attack mode, and I can get just as vicious. I mean, I can sit down and cut deals, but I don't want to come to the table that way. And when I came to the table with kindness last week, I got shredded. And now I got another attorney involved because my attorney was weak, jelly belly, jellyfish back weak. And I had to go grab another attorney and get set up for round two, you know? And now this lady's stalling, and I don't want to play this kind of game, but when you're in a multi-trillion-dollar industry trying to cut deals, you got sharks out there. When you bleed in the water, the sharks will come, and they are ruthless. And I'm like, what in the heck am I doing here? Like, I'm trying to be nice. And even the kindness in covering up her mess, she came to a meeting and she didn't even know she scheduled it the way she scheduled it. And then she's calling me wanting to know why I'm not picking up my phone. I'm like, hey, my phone's on mute because the meeting that you scheduled, that's a webinar, is like, it's happening over here. And I just shut off my phone. But I said, I'm keeping the ball rolling until you come on in. So just take your time. So I'm saying, hey, how was your weekend? And this lady's like, oh, my grandkids. I'm like, oh, that's great. And then she jumps on and she goes, hey, everybody, I'm sorry I'm late. I'm like, that's all right. I said, how was your weekend? She goes, I'm not here to talk about my weekend. I'm here to talk about this contract. Beep. Because I got a 10 o'clock meeting and it's 9:37. I'm thinking, you just screwed up 7 minutes of my time, babe. But hey, I'm trying to cover your... So let's get it together. Beep, beep,
beep. So if 5 minutes till it's done, then I got to go in with a sword. And I go, hey, I just want to let you know, Leanne, you got 5 minutes. You can grab yourself a cup of coffee, go to the bathroom, and you can still be at your appointment at 10 o'clock.
Okay, cool. I love it. I love everything you just shared there.
So I'm struggling with this because when I hear this Yogananda talking about kindness dissolving nothing, I'm still working it out because emotionally I get ramped up. I'm in a place of fear. I'm trying to understand what's going on and deliver personalities of people I've never met before. I can't see, I can't get a read on. And so now all I got to do is lawyer up because I don't know what I'm doing. So, you know, you try and be kind, but at the same time, it can be taken advantage of. And so I'm trying to find a way to mentally stay focused and not get me off my game. And because that's where it's at. It's a me issue at the end of the day that I've got to learn to be able to stay composed and walk through this without getting up dumped the way I did last week. So it's a great learning experience. And all of this here, I'm taking into the next meeting that I'm still waiting over a week now for her to schedule.
Excellent. So would you like me to share some thoughts on this situation?
only if it will help everybody else too.
Absolutely. I'd say, oh, can I ever relate to everything you described? I think we all can, and it sucks. It's like you got somebody who's got such a difficult personality despite your best efforts. Sucks. We've all been there. I would also submit to everybody that your spiritual curriculum in the school of life is in the relationships where you currently have the most disharmony, right? So you are in the middle of the curriculum. You're not supposed to have this figured out yet. This is the curriculum you're in, you know? So one big thing is this, kindness doesn't mean being nice and making yourself a doormat. So what really, one of the kindest things you can do is really not enable people in these patterns. So I try to view it from a level of concerned parent. And I train, and one of the things Tony Robbins would say is, you have to train people to treat you the way you want them to treat you. So it's like this, hey, how you doing? What outcome do you want? If you act this way, I will respond by acting this way. If you behave this way, I'm going to react by responding this way. You have the choice. The choice is yours. Okay? If you act this way, rude and stuff, I'm actually not even going to talk to you. Like, and so if that's the outcome you want, behave that way. Like, the people, especially difficult people, love control. A lot of their moodiness comes from lack of control in life. So I give them control and let them know exactly how I will behave and respond to their actions in advance. I'm very kind. I'll be like, if you do this, I'm dropping the deal today. If you do this, we're cool. We get along, we're friends. I'm just highlighting the options before we move forward on how I'm going to respond to your behavior, but it's your choice. And that's it. They actually, surprisingly, people respond very well when you give them options because they feel in control.
So I followed up on that with an email about respect, how we are to behave and respond during these negotiations, and the fact that I didn't like the fact that she blew off a meeting without any notification when I had an attorney present that I had to pay for anyway.
Yeah.
And she refused to respond to me, but instead let another lady who's more diplomatic, more corporate, respond. Now, it wasn't clean, but she pulled her right out. And now nobody's responding. I gave them dates, told them when my attorney and I could be available, and I still haven't heard any response back. But their whole deal is, well, we have an internal issue with a customer, and so we had to just, you know, get rid of your appointment. I said, that's great. Now that you have that internal client customer issue taken care of, let's get back to the customer issue that we have here on the table that wants to work with me and needs the contract set between you and I. Let's get back to the table and get this rolling. Here are some dates that we're all available. No response. It's been over a week. So, you know, I realize the holiday and people been out and stuff like that. I'm letting it dial down a little bit because my attorney's out until Friday. But at the end of the day, these, Charmaine, are tough places to be because you sit in this corporate arena all day long. When you're doing B2B business, it's one thing. It's when you're just B to customer, you know, B to C, you know, they're the customer, you're doing whatever you can, and you can manipulate that in a lot of different ways through behavior. But man, you're up against some sharks, and then you've got political power, control, all of these other things that you're dealing with. That's a lot to have to, you know, work through. So I appreciate where you sit inside corporate, because I couldn't do it, girl. I'd be in jail.
So one of the things you could do strategically with people like this is it's all about setting boundaries. If you blow off meetings, I will respond by doing exactly this thing. If you ignore my email and don't respond by this date, here's how I respond. If you do this, 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 here's what I do. It's really being tough like that. But they were like, that's the skill of learning that tough love. It's tough love because you're giving them advance notice of ways you're going to react and respond. But you're going to say, look, I told you that if you blew off a meeting, I was just taking your ass straight to court. Like that, like if you ignore my emails, I escalate things. If I don't get the response in 3 days, I escalate things by doing this very specific thing.
Yeah.
Like a lot of it can come down to, in the corporate world, can come down to that. Choice closes always, because people who are difficult have a token resistance against being told what to do. They hate being told what to do, because they feel like it's a sign of weakness and they just have this lust for power and control. So that's your spiritual curriculum, figuring out that and figuring out how to be at peace with that. And I've been there. And when you win people over, they are the most loyal ever, because very few people ever can win them over. And I've had to win over the most difficult personalities in my career, and working in private medicine with the wealthiest 5% of Canadians, all CEOs and judges and everything else. And I've got a crack, and they would give me the hardest personalities, and I'd have to get through to all of them. And it was like, just, I go right into concerned parent mode. I'm not your equal. Mm-hmm. I'm more like a concerned parent in this situation. And I'm going to let you know how your actions are going to cause these react. Your actions will cause these reactions. I'm going to let you know straight up, so you can choose your own adventure, right? Like, that's it. But I'm fair.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's a lot like parenting.
Yeah, that's really good. I really appreciate this insight and perspective. It helps me because I'm growing, I'm learning and growing in this. And it is mm-hmm. definitely the gym, and it's a muscle I'm trying to build.
Oh, you're learning how to love the unlovable. That's a very high spiritual lesson. Congratulations. That's good curriculum to be on. Figuring out how to love the unlovable, and that you realize that they're very instinctive and reactive, much more than you think. Don't expect them to be much more advanced. They always want to be in control. So if there's an anthem to their lives, it's I did it my way. They always just want to feel like they're doing everything their way, right? So a lot of the coaching I've had to do with people over the years is dealing with these difficult personalities who act like that, right? They just love to be in control of everything. So anyways, hopefully that gives you some stuff to experiment with. All option closes. You lay out your options on everything well in advance. Train people to treat you the way that you want them to treat you. That's it. That's a skill you're learning right now. It's a great skill. You'll reap the rewards on that one for the rest of your life. So thank you for that share. Thank you for that share. Chris, takeaways from tonight.
I think, still muted.
Chris, you're on mute again.
There you go. Got it.
No, I'm unmuted. I think one of the biggest takeaways is to kind of reconnect with what humanity truly is. And I love Patty's explanation of her situation. because humanity is not always opening up. You're going at 50,000. We can tell everybody how much we love you, because there are people out there with very sinister strategies and very sinister plots who are coming after you. So you cannot be in that mode when they're in a different mode. Is that your fault? No. But you got to defend yourself, and you have to win the situation. That is what negotiating is. You have to look at it as a chess game. I had, when I owned a restaurant, a couple was going to buy another coffee, was going to buy a coffee shop to start their own business. The guy, all of a sudden, at the very end, started to renegotiate everything, which made her feel very uncertain, and she was very upset by this. But that's what negotiating is to try to get the best value on your side. Mm-hmm. So I explained to her that this is a normal tactic and technique, is that just as the time of closing, people, he's going to try to jostle the board to see if he can get any more money out of you. And that's really all he's doing. At the end of the day, he will sign that contract. He's put too much time and effort into you, and he's just negotiation tactics. And when you're dealing with these other people who are sharks, they, like, if you ever watch Shark Tank, you watch Mr. Wonderful, and you see how cute, why they call him that, because of how fuzzy and warm he is. That's kind of what, there are people in the world who are like that. And you will have to deal with them, which is great. That is good. Why? Because now you're learning how to handle somebody with that type of personality, where their values are completely different than yours in a professional realm. You're bringing your personal things to try to help protect you and help take advantage of the situation, which are not there, because that's not how they're playing. That's not what they're looking at. You have to play the game of, not according to their rules, but with the same set of rules. You're playing with some different rules than they are. And you have to kind of find an intermediate that's going to help, that's going to play, keep the rule, keep the game, the playing field level. And you're dealing with professionals. And now, and this is what you're training yourself to do now, is to be that professional. What type of mindset do I have to be to deal with this lady and pound her to the ground until she's crying and going home to mommy? That's how you're going to get this person to respond to you, is by reflecting. Remember that Tony Robbins story when he was talking about the guy who said, you know, I'm pissed off. I don't like how people are treated. Yeah, I agree. They all suck, don't they? And he has the next page and says, you know, they really don't like me. So it has to be that way. You have to reflect their energy and their values back at them. And that's is because humanity has very different hues, colors, shapes, sizes. This is a different hue, shape, and size than what you're used to dealing with or want to deal with. But good. God's giving you this opportunity to learn how to deal with this type of person that you don't want to deal with. That's how you grow. Okay, that's enough for me.
Yeah. I always get so entertained by Chris's combination of humor and wisdom. He's got such a great blend of it. How is this challenging you to grow? That's his question for you, right? How is this challenging you to grow? Key takeaways. Joel.
So.
There lies the essence of humanity.
Nice. It's really interesting. What you were saying about how to deal with someone like that, exactly what parenting is. And it's, I don't, luckily I don't have to usually deal with people like that, but it's really good to file that away in the toolbox, because if you have that skill set going into something, you're totally right. Like you, trying to control the situation just butts heads with the person. Like, the best way you can do it is what you're just saying. Like, hey, you know, you're in control, but just so you know, this equals this. And, you know, if you do this, then I'll do this. And that cool thing is, it still leaves it where they feel like they're in control, but really kind of you're controlling it. You're just not doing it the way that they're perceiving off the top. Anyway, so that was really great. I also really appreciate, like, you can never talk enough about looking through the lens of love and shared family when you see any other person, even the person you're negotiating with. Like, I get Chris's point about you got to be a shark, you got to bring to the table, but it's also somebody's kid. Like, you know, they're scared, they got burned, like they got put in this job they didn't want to be. I don't know, like, I'm not really qualified to judge why they're a bitter shark in that table, but, you know, it doesn't necessarily mean that I would, like, you know, come to that with, you know, vulnerability necessarily, but I would just see them, even if it's just in my own thought, I would see them as another child of God that's loved and cared for like the rest of us. And sometimes that change in my thinking is enough to change the situation. And, you know, it gets into metaphysics. And then the third thing was really early on when we talked about, you know, my challenge with the stuff that I'm working on, and you really hit the nail on the head with just that it's, you know, change what it means, like meaning, and, you know, Tony's big on that too, like meaning that we assign things is everything. Like, and I tell this to my kids like every day, like they get into these tantrums or, you know, they're not feeling well, whatever it is. It's like, well, what does it mean to you? Does it mean like, you know, somebody did something and they hate you and it's going to be the worst day of your life? Or like, maybe it's just a stepping stone. This could be the best day of your life. Like, meaning is everything. So that's also a really great reminder, especially for me, as I, you know, look on things like making calls to people that I'm assigning this meaning that it's this awkward, painful thing. And maybe I should just give it a meaning of like, it's this awesome, exciting way that I get to help people. Who wouldn't want to do that? So yeah, lots of good takeaways.
I think that's a great point. Like,
thank you.
So many awesome points there. So many awesome points, Joel. And one of the great things you kind of said is reframing the meaning. Like, in some ways, I remember I was in a similar situation to Patty, and that person I ended up realizing later on was my teacher for that phase of my life. I didn't like their teaching style, but me not liking it got my attention and prioritization, right? So it's like, you don't like all that. You're going to get teachers in life, and they will be pain teachers and pleasure teachers. Pleasure teachers are great. You just wish they were all like them. But then you're going to get these pain teachers, and it really gets your attention, and it brings to the surface some of the stuff so that it can be resolved that's inside of us, right? So
the cool thing is you're framing everything as teaching, right? Because then it's all good.
Yeah. Yeah. So lots of awesome points there, Joel. I loved so much of what you said there. So much powerful stuff. Remembering that they're a child of God, like, that's God's creation. God has a plan for that soul's journey, right? Like, there's a divine director that is behind this. And, you know, movies aren't really great when things are good all the time. Like, movies are good precisely because of the inspirational transition from struggle to success, right? And that's this person's spiritual story in this lifetime. You know, one of the ways I look at things is to pretend, you know, whether or not this is true, imagine this. Imagine that you have to reincarnate to come back and share love and wisdom with people until every single soul has succeeded in the journey of spiritual perfection. Just imagine that's the reality of your existence and live into that. And then the amount of compassion, patience, and everything else that'll come to you in terms of how you're going to live your life may bring you greater empowerment and harmony. And just treat everyone like that. It's like, look, I got to come here to help you at some point, whether it's this lifetime or another lifetime, whatever. We're going to do this the easy way or the hard way. If you want to go through hell again and live with this greedy, like, lousy mood, Rick, whatever, I'll do the dance with you. And but if you want to get out of this, then playtime's over. Let's get out of this playroom. Like, it's up to you.
Better get cracking.
Yeah, exactly.
Got a lot of work to do.
Exactly. So lots of great stuff there. Charmaine, do you have any key takeaways from tonight?
Yeah, I think what I'm reflecting on is my mom has told me I was born with a sensitivity to people that, from what I've read from brain studies and stuff, you really shouldn't have until you were like 5. So I don't know where that came from. But I intuitively seem to understand, you know, things that would provoke a response in people. I was under a year old and somebody had my blanket and I wanted it. And I told my mom and, you know, I said, but I didn't want to take it from him because he would cry. Don't ask me why, I figured that out. But she told me if I brought another toy and tried giving it to him, he probably would just let me have it. You know, but I had that sensitivity. And then as I got older, you know, I was interested in everything. And my younger brother struggled a lot and he wanted to do art. And I'm like, great, let's all go learn art. You know, and I thought it was a great idea. And my mom told me he needed to have something of his own. And I needed to let him have that and have his space. And I needed to not do that at this point because I needed to let him have something he could feel about that he didn't have to share with the rest of us because he struggled, you know, just to feel like he had some self-esteem. And I'll never forget those lessons. And it's made me a much kinder person and a lot softer with people. But I think as a result, you know, some of the stuff Patty was talking about tonight, sometimes I struggle with how to interact with people and where that appropriate boundary is, you know, to stand up for myself or put certain restrictions in place. That's the part that I didn't learn. I learned to be kind and I learned to, you know, give people room to grow. I learned sometimes if I feel compelled to deliver a message, I deliver the message, but I don't wait around to look to see that they learned. It's my job to deliver the message and not be connected to the learning. But also if you don't have a relationship with people, I know sometimes there's forced relationships, but if you don't have a relationship, you don't also have that opportunity to be a good influence in their life. And so, like I said, I'm obviously struggling on the other side, how to stand up for myself or put those appropriate boundaries in place on the other side of it to protect myself or look out for myself in that. So there's been some good discussion on that tonight. I still don't know that I have all the answers or I have it intuitively figured out, but it's given me a lot to think about.
Yeah, I think in essence, it's training people to treat you the way you want them to treat you. How you do that, there's various options. Choice, close, and letting people know you act this way, I respond this way, that way, I respond that way. Super effective. Super effective. My whole career, I've been working with difficult personalities, just straight up. Like I've had to specialize in really difficult people who want everything their way, right? Like that's been the client that Patty described is my typical client over the past 18 years. And I'm one of the few people they actually trust in their life who tells them what to do. But when I hear that story, I'm like, that's like so many people I know. But I've gotten to a place where they were like that at first. And I was able to get into a harmonious situation with them. But I was able to do the dance of tough love. And it's a fine art. And it's a skill. But when you break through to them, like they are extremely loyal to anybody. They have high standards, super high standards. We will have extreme loyalty. You know,
I can get the loyalty, but I haven't figured out how to do it without feeling like, you know, I'm protecting myself in it as well. You know, that's the hard
part. Yeah. So that's where you be clear on the boundaries of, if you do this, this is how I respond. And you have to have the courage to set those boundaries. And you have to know that that is the just and right thing to do. Because otherwise you are a complicit ally in unjust behavior. So you have to know that setting that boundary is the just thing to do, or you're enabling, right? Yeah. If you do this, well, this is how I react.
I wonder if there's room, you know, circling back to we were trying to find common ground with people, right? So what if you just, in the same concept of setting boundaries, just from the beginning, like, look, we both want to get a deal done. Like we both want, you know, good to come out of it. Like what's the quickest way with the least amount of pain we can do this? Like set that expectation so that it's not just like, well, I'm gonna get my thing, you're gonna get your thing, and back and forth. It's just like I feel like there's negotiators sometimes that lay that out, that just say, hey, you know, we both want something, we're both willing to give a little bit, you know, let's get this done, like let's not waste each other's time.
That's so interesting you say that, Joel, because one of my close friends the very first conversation we had was not good. She's very aggressive and was really upset at me. We hadn't even met. And I don't even remember this, but she told me like a month ago that the reason she respects me so much is after that happened, I said, let's just talk and figure this out. You know, there's no reason we can't figure this out. And just saying that to her completely changed the dynamic of the relationship. I don't even remember saying that. It's something I totally would say, but I don't even remember it, but it seemed to be what she needed, you know? So it's interesting you say that because I hadn't really put it together until you said it.
There was a point Joel said that that I thought was really good, and it had to do with inner peace. And when I'm looking at somebody, I don't care what material wealth they have. To me, material wealth is so overrated. It's like a kid making a mud pie. I'm like, that's so childish, like that you think that's the scorecard of success of any kind. To me, when I look at people, I'm like, your success scorecard is your inner peace. Like, if you don't have very much inner peace, I don't care how big your house is and how big your car is. Like, to me, I look at you like much more sympathetic. And I'm like, and actually you've built up all these other things because you can't find what you're really looking for, which is your inner peace, right? So when I meet up with somebody and they're battling on something like money, contract negotiation, I'm like, isn't this cute? Like, this is so cute. Like, you think this stuff actually matters, but you, and you know, you can have money, but you can't really have this inner peace right now if you're gonna live like that. Like, you can't really have what you deep down want, you know, just zooming out and viewing things from that perspective. So I added my really rough notes on this topic into the chat. The notes are rough because I haven't actually like given this as a handout. It's always been a conversation I had with people to be a good influence in their life, to help them create greater harmony where they have differences. Now, today we're talking about difficult personalities, which is different. Like how we ended was a little bit different because it was really about superficial classifications, but it's all good. But now we're dealing with difficult personalities, which is, we could devote a whole night to that. And really it comes down to option closes. Like that's, I had to read books on this. Like Dr. Richard Rome was one of the main people. Like I studied this because everyone I got was like the client that Patty described. Like that was all my clients. I was like, how do I have so many difficult people that are so selfish and lousy and everything else? But once I got to understand them, then I got to actually positively influence them. So that's something to think about. So just to highlight main things from tonight, one of the main problems is focusing on our differences rather than our commonalities, physically, mentally, spiritually, how we're all interconnected, why this awareness of common humanity matters, and what remembering what needs to be remembered moving forward. Those are the big components of tonight. This is a conversation you may have with people if they're open with you and honest. Like, you really can't succeed at living a human life till you can find harmony with all the other fellow crew on this spaceship called planet Earth, like straight up. Because then you're living in existence with other threats, right? So it threatens your inner peace to just have these people in existence. So I think that's it's a more challenging lesson, I think. So really tonight's just opening the dialogue on this topic. Like, let's just look at it that way. No pressure to grasp or really kind of master or internalize this stuff. It's just, we're opening the conversation on the subject of common humanity. That's it. All right. So, Patty, what time is it? What time is it?
It's time for group hug and sound off for the evening. So, on the count of three, we are going to give each other a group hug because I'm all about physical touch. And then after that, we are going to fist bump each other and go out in style. Are you ready?
Yes.
One, woo-hoo! Two, three, group hug. I love you guys so much.
Love you guys.
Love you.
Love you guys.
You were all amazing out there today. Everybody crushed it.
Have a great week, guys.
Bye, guys.
Amazing week.
You too, Joel.
Be your best selves.